Morning, church. Grab your Bible, Psalm 35. If you're new, we're going through the Psalms. We're headed to 41, not today, but that's the goal. And that'll sort of sum up for us book one of the Psalms. And then we'll kind of, see where we're at. I think we'll do a summer series and kind of push pause on the Psalms. Although I have just absolutely been loving the Psalms, and I think just the Lord has divinely orchestrated for us to be in this book, the book of Psalms, during this time. And if you're new, just let me give you like a quick review, because not all the Psalms are the same. And the one we're going to look at today, Psalm 35, and hopefully we'll save a little bit of time to jump into 36. A lot of guys skip it. A lot of guys in my line of work will just jump over Psalm 35. We're not going to do that. We're going to look at it. And the reason, I really believe that the Lord has a definite word that he wants to say to us in regards to the 35th Psalm. But the reason a lot of guys just gloss over it is because it's not necessarily praise-based. A lot of the Psalms that we love, I'll just give you sort of this summary if you're new. This is kind of what we've seen together. You have praise-based Psalms that we just absolutely love. And just like right out of the gate, Psalm 1, praise-based, hallelujah. And then you have prayer-based Psalm. We spent a month in Psalm 23, just sort of increasing our love and just the power of having a prayer life. There's prayer-based psalms. There's prostrate-based psalm. That's when you're on your face. This is probably the prone position where you are just surrendered. That's prostrate, just surrendered before the Lord. And that's a powerful psalm, just to give it all to God. And a lot of the psalms instruct us and become the vehicle to help us just handing that burden and that care over to the Lord. And then there's prophetic-based psalms. I love these. Prophetic is going to speak a word of knowledge, a word of instruction into a moment, into a scene, into a situation. It could be present day, could be futuristic. A lot of prophetic psalms are telling us, sort of forth-telling what's going to be happening at the end of the age. But a lot of the psalms prophetically are going to speak a word into whatever it is you're faced with this week. For example, Bon, my wife, is having surgery in the morning. First thing, out of the gate, surgery, found something when she had her emergency appendectomy that's got to be pulled out, taken out. And so just a lot of folks in the church praying for her, just loving on her. Family, we need your prayers as much as you need ours, and just kind of just believing prophetically that he is going to be my gal's great physician. Amen. That's just a prophetic word, and amen. So she'll be in for several days. It's not like a quick thing in and out, but I'm getting her back better than ever. Good as new. And then you have punishment-based psalms. So anyone want to guess which of those we're venturing into today? That's why a lot of guys skip it, because 35 is punishment-based. Now, if it's praise-based, your hands are up. You're just like crazy, bringing on the worship. Hallelujah. We love praise-based psalm. Hands are high. Prayer-based, I'm the grandpa in the room. A lot of grandpas in the room. Teaching these little kids, okay, we fold our hands, we bow our head. A prayer-based psalm, your hands are folded, your hands are together. Prostrate, a surrender-based psalm, where your hand? Hands up. And hands up, not necessarily in a praise position of hands high, but in a surrendered position. Hands up. Just surrendered over to the Lordship of God Almighty. Prophetic-based, your hands are out. You're kind of like, Bob, we're claiming healing with you for Bond. Or hands are out and prophetically pointing people to how the Lord says things are all going to wrap up. So hands are pointed out. Punishment-based, where do you think your hands are? Hands off. This is my best description, sort of a summary of the Psalms. And so much would the posture be for us to have a hands-off position in regards to a punishment-based psalm that a lot of guys don't even go near it with a 10-foot pole. But there's a lot of them. This is a imprecatory psalm. Imprecatory. If you've never heard of that, good. It makes me feel better about the money I spent and the time I was away from my family in seminary. An imprecatory psalm is a curse. It's a curse-based psalm. It is punishment-related. It's and quite honestly, I believe for us the lesson is not to get in God's way and not to sort of presume that we can play the role of God in doling out the punishments, although that's exactly where David goes. Let me show you. Look what he says. Plead my cause, O Lord. That's a very churchy Sunday morning religious way of David saying, get down here. Plead my cause, O Lord, with those who strive with me, and fight against those who fight against me. Look what he says, verse 2. Take hold of shield and buckler. Can you imagine saying that to God? What's he saying? Get dressed for battle. Wake up there. Hey, put your armor on. And get down here and fight for me. Stand, look what he says. Stand up for my help. Draw out the spear. Look at this. Draw out the spear and stop those who pursue me. That is poetic, but that clearly is David saying, run them through. Run them through, God. Stop those who pursue me and say to my soul, I'm your salvation. Come on, win the day for me down here. We just sang about it. I'm going to give you the victory. Get down here and give me the victory. And then verse 4, he says, let. Everyone say let. This is not let like Wimbledon let. This isn't let serve. You can try again. Let serve in tennis is like a mulligan in golf. You get a do-over. This is not that kind of let. This is let them have it, Lord. Unleash all the wrath of heaven and let them have it. He's going to say it like 20-some-odd times. So buckle up. Watch out. Here he goes. Let those be put to shame who brought dishonor, who seek after my life. Let those be turned back who brought to confusion, who plot my hurt. Let them be like chaff. Blow them away, is what he's saying. Blow them away, Lord. Let them have it. Let them be like chaff. Blow them away. Let the angel of the Lord chase them. Sick them. This is a sick them psalm. Sick them. Sick them, Lord. And some of you right now are like, finally, I have chapter and verse. I've got it. Yes! Sick them, Lord. Get them, Lord. Right? And we saw more protests yesterday over gun control in our country than we've ever seen before. It's just sort of like, yeah, like grab your shield and buckler, get your armor on, and get down here. Let them have it. Let them have it, Lord. Let the angels chase after the wicked. Let their way be dark and slippery. Let the angel of the Lord pursue them. For without cause they have hidden their net for me in a pit, which they have dug without cause for my life. Let them have it, Lord. Let destruction come on him unexpectedly. And let his net that he has hidden catch himself. Into that very destruction, let him fall. This is an imprecatory Imprecation. Imprecation means you are hurling the imprecation of judgment, of calamity, of cursing. Literally, this is it. Listen, I'm not using too strong enough language. He is damning his enemy. Let them be caught in their own net. Look at this. Into that very destruction, let him fall. It's sort of like, this is David saying, let them all go to, yeah. It's sort of like that, you know, in Esther, there's that amazing story of Haman who builds the gallows to see his enemy hung on the gallows, and Haman ends up getting hung himself on the gallows he constructed. He gets hung on his own gallows, and that's what David is praying. Let them be caught in the net they have used to try and catch. Let them fall. And then he stops, verse 9, he stops and he's like, and then my soul's going to be happy. look at, and my soul will be joyful in the Lord. You come to my defense, you get down here, and you fight this for me, and I will be happy. I will be joyful in the Lord. I will rejoice in his salvation. All my bones will say, Lord, who is like you? Come on, win the day. Be my hero, delivering the poor from him who is too strong for him. Yes, the poor and the needy from him who plunders him. Fierce witnesses rise up and they ask me things that I do not know and reward me evil for good to the sorrow of my soul. But as for me, when they were sick, my clothing was sackcloth. I humbled myself with fasting. My prayer would return to my own heart. I paced about as though he were my friend. My brother, I bow down heavily as one who mourns for his mom. David's like, this one really stung. Because it wasn't some pagan stranger. It was from within. That is the most difficult pain to deal with. When you've been betrayed by the kiss of a friend. That's David's like, what happened to old Uncle Saul who said, if you beat this big giant for me, my house is your house. You're going to sit at my table. You're not going to pay taxes the rest of your life. You can marry my daughter. This has gotten personal. My adversity, they rejoice, and they gathered together. Attackers gathered against me. I didn't know it. They tore at me. I didn't cease. Ungodly mockers at feast, they gnashed at me with their teeth. I think that is actually very end times prophetic. What he's describing happening over there around the banquet table that he thought he was going to be invited, not as a guest, but now as a family member, to enjoy all of the spoils of the victory of fighting this Goliath and being Saul's guy and musician, and now they're all sitting over at the banquet table and they're rejoicing, and I'm not there, I'm not invited, I'm left out, and they're just mocking me at their feast. And he's like, in verse 17, he's like super, super transparent, David is. He's just like so raw in this psalm. He's like, how long are you going to look on? Rescue me from their destruction. Get down here. This is a salsa psalm. How do you like your salsa? My bon likes it very mild. And there is some there's some of these punishment-based psalms that are rather mild. Like Psalm 7 is the first one of a host, many of them. So like, if you're going to ignore that they're actually in there and just kind of, well, we're just going to camp out with the praise-based psalms, you're going to write off a lot of a lot of these punishment-based songs. And this one's rather, this would be medium. How do you like your salsa? And then you're like, oh, I like it spicy, man. I like it hot. And you're like, bring it. That's like Psalm 107. You get up into Psalm 107, and I think 30 different times the psalmist is declaring a curse on his enemy. He's like, it's like Psalm 35 on steroids. It just goes crazy. And here he is. He's sort of like, get down here. How long are you going to just be up there looking down at the mess of this country and planet that's just spiraling out of control? It's just getting, get out, rescue me from their, my precious life from these lions, and I'll give you thanks in the great assembly. I'll praise you amongst many people. And then he's back to the let's, verse 19. Let them not rejoice over me who are wrongfully my enemies, nor let them wink with the eye who hate me without a cause. They don't speak peace. They devise deceitful matters against the quiet ones in the land. They've opened their mouth wide against me. They've said, aha, aha, our eyes have seen it. We see who you really are. This you have seen, Lord. So don't keep silent. Don't be far from me. Stir up yourself and awake. Hey, wake up. Up there. Get down. Vindication to my cause, my God, and my, vindicate me according to your righteousness. And let them not rejoice over me, and let them not say in their hearts, ah, we would have had, and let them not say we have swallowed him up. Let them be ashamed, brought to mutual confusion, who rejoice at my hurt. Let them be clothed with shame and dishonor. That's a hurling imprecation of judgment and cursing right there. Let them, shame on them, he's saying. Shame and dishonor who exalt themselves against me. Let them shout for joy and be glad who favor my righteous cause. And let them say continually, let the Lord be magnified who has pleasure in the prosperity of his servant. And my tongue will speak of your righteousness and of your praise all the day long. Where do you put this? Where do you put this song? Because you have to see it in the full counsel of Scripture. And when you do, although it has context, it does. Please understand, the context of this psalm is the Abrahamic promise of God declaring in Genesis 12, I will bless those who bless you, and I will... So here's the curse, Psalm 35. So where do we put this? Because in the full counsel of God, in the fullness of Scripture, you have a Savior who now shows up and says, what's he say? Well, in the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5, he says, you've heard it said. And you could actually, like, parentheses, Psalm 35, you've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. I say to you, love your enemy and bless those who curse you. Do good to those who hate you and pray for those who spitefully use you and persecute you. See, so now you're like, what do we do with the 35th Psalm? Because Jesus just doesn't say it once. Later in Luke, look at this in Luke. In Luke, he says, I say to you who hear, and a lot of people don't want to hear this. A lot of people are like, oh yeah, man, I've got a new favorite Psalm. Hold on. Because I say to you who hear, love your enemy. Do good to those who hate you and bless those who curse. That's not what David's doing. David's getting pulled down and saying, well, everyone else is doing it. I think I'd be okay just to curse along with the rest of them. No. Bless those who curse you and pray for those who spitefully use you. And to him who strikes you on the cheek, offer the other one also. For him who takes away your cloak, don't withhold the tunic. You're just like, whoa, wow, what? So what? This is some unhinged anger coming down in the 35th Psalm. Where do you put it? He's like, I don't know. I don't have a shelf for it. Okay, let's build one. Because some have sort of wanted to look at Psalm 35 and write it off. Like guys that I love, guys that I fully respect, they're going through a series on the Psalms. This one seems to get leapfrogged. And then there'll be like a little asterisk or a little notation. This is uninspired. Excuse me? Uninspired. Yeah, this is the writings of a fallen man. This is David venting. This is David fleshing out. This is not inspired of God. Hold on. Where does that logic go when all of a sudden now you've put yourself into the spot of deciding which scriptures are inspired and which ones aren't inspired? That's liberalism. And liberalism is why the church is in the mess that the church is in. So that can't be the box that you put this in. You can't be like going liberal and saying, okay, well, now I'm actually going to be the judge and jury on the scriptures that I like and the scriptures that I don't like and the ones that apply and the ones that I think are still relevant and the ones that is above your pay grade and mine as well. That's a slippery slope, church. And we can't be deciding what we like, what we don't like, what we're comfortable with, what we're not comfortable with. You can't go there. So next to that one, number three, they spiritualize it. Oh, this is actually, it's David, they spiritualize it. They're like, he's talking about the devil. No, he's not. That might be a convenient category to just spiritualize it and say, oh, he's going after the big enemy. No, he's going after specific guys. And so all of a sudden, it just doesn't really help us to think that we can kind of gloss over it in spiritualizing that. Well, you just, no, nice try. Or well, they'll just call it, well, this is old covenant. They'll go covenantal on it. And a lot will take an imprecatory psalm and drop it in a covenantal camp and say, well, Bob, maybe I just need to remind you, in the Old Testament, God was a little cranky. He was kind of grumpy. He was a grumpy God. And then, just like you read to us from Matthew and from Luke, this nice Jesus comes along. That's covenantal thinking. And the Bible wants to clear that thinking up and say he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. You're not talking about two different gods. One God, the Shema, is that we worship one God. So don't go covenantal on that. You go covenantal on this, all of a sudden you're like, well, the Old Testament, that's full of all the cursings. And then you get to the New Testament, that's full of all the blessings. And that might sound really convenient, you know, for a lot of churchgoers who just want 20-minute sermons. Sermonettes are for Christianettes. And you will miss out on a lot of blessings that are actually found in the Old Covenant. Some of the biggest blessings you want to bank on are found in the Old Testament. And so don't like write it off and say, well, that's when he was grumpy. Nor would we want to think that it's only blessings in the New Testament, because this actual nice guy, Jesus, who shows up with hippie hair and flowers and everyone follow me. And he actually walks into Capernaum and he says, Capernaum, you're cursed. What happened to the nice guy? He's like saying to a whole town, you know what he says? It's going to be better for Sodom and Gomorrah than it is for you guys. That's New Testament. That's Jesus saying to one of the biggest curses found in Scripture that what happened to them isn't going to compare to what's happening to you in his home base camp beach town on the northern shore of the Sea of Galilee. And then he keeps walking into the next town. He goes to the sister city of Capernaum. He goes to Bethsaida, and he goes, and same for you guys. You're cursed too. So you can't go covenantal on it. You can't go covenantal when actually the Apostle Paul writes to the church of Galatia and says, if anybody preaches to you guys another gospel, let him be what?
Cursed.
So it's not just curses in the old and blessings in the new. You can't just covenantal this thing. So that can't be our out. So some will just say, well, this is expired. This is expired text. What? I got guys right now, famous preachers, that want to say the movement and work and fruit of the Holy Spirit expired. Expired at the end of the apostolic age. Like it isn't in play. Nonsense. There's no expiration date to the Holy Spirit. And there's no expiration date to Scripture. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will never pass away. There's no expiration date on this. So some will look at it, and it validates their anger. They're like, yay, I get to be grumpy. I got a verse and a chapter, new favorite, Psalm 35. Get them, God. Sick them with hot, spicy salsa. No, this... And there are times, honestly, I would just have to admit, I'd be lying if I didn't, that I'd like this to validate my anger. Isn't it often the case, you play sports, your kids play sports? I think it's true probably in all sports. It's not the one that instigates. It's the one that retaliates that the ref seems to notice. Right? That's true in hockey. And the guy retaliates, and he's like, 2 minutes in the sin bin, man. 2 minutes, you in the penalty box. But did you see what he did? No, I didn't see that. I saw you. And I think the strategy of the enemy right now, in light of all of the instigation of darkness and evil, is for us to retaliate in such a way that would make us no different than them. This can't validate your anger. This can't be you and I now having as much road rage as the guy next to you. He had more riots and protests over guns yesterday than any time in the history of this country. So where do you put this on? You just sort of like walk out of here and say, oh wow, this now I'm gonna be praying the prayer of David over you. No. Spurgeon says this about Psalm 35. Spurgeon says, guided by God's Spirit. Now this is clutch. This is so important because it isn't just David venting. It's not just David fleshing out. This is David being guided by God's Spirit. The psalmist simply foretells the everlasting confusion of all the haters of the righteous. Shameful disappointment shall be the portion of all enemies of the gospel. Wow. Just soak that in. That's heavy. I mean, rightfully so, we're going to have the comfort food of pancakes following this study, because this is a heavy song. Shameful disappointment shall be the portion of all enemies of the gospel, nor would the most tender-hearted Christian in the room right now have it otherwise. Viewing sinners as men, okay, here's now taking and supplementing the Sermon on the Mount, the teachings of Jesus. You've heard it said, you can hate your enemy. Go ahead. No, I say to you, love your enemy. So viewing sinners as men, we love them. Love them, you guys. We love them. And we seek their good. But we're not naive about it either. And as enemies of God, look at this. We can't think of them with anything but a desire for the confusion of their devices. And that's what David's, Lord, confuse them. Confuse the strategies of Satan. And squeamish sentimentality may object to the strong language being, there's some strong language in Psalm 35. It's like, sick 'em, God. But in their hearts, all good men and women wish confusion to mischief makers. No loyal subject can wish success to rebels. And so David is simply, let me sum this up. David is an inspired writer, as Spurgeon has just said, who is being inspired to write what God is wanting written. It's not just David fleshing out. In 2 Peter chapter 1, there's an amazing verse, the very last verse of that first chapter in 2 Peter that says, this has never for a second been written by the will of man. This isn't the will of David that we're reading about in Psalm 35. Holy men were moved by the Holy Spirit. And so this is inspired writers like David and others who wrote what God wanted written. So why did he want this written? See, David's life and what David is faced with now becomes for us the practical grid to see how to face the things facing us. David becomes the pen, but God remains the key. That's my equation for this chapter. D is the P, David is the pen, G is the key, God is the key. God's behind it all. And he is inspiring David through David's circumstance to write about what judgment ultimately is going to look like from the perspective of the authoritative author, that being God. David's simply the pen. D is the P, G is the key. And this Psalm 35, don't write it off. Don't throw it into, well, it's just like expired like a carton of milk. No. Oh, well, I'm just going to spiritualize it. No. It is a peek. Look at, through David's circumstance, you're getting a peek into the holiness of God. You're getting a peek into God's holiness. And get this. Here's the bonus. You're getting a peek into the everlasting, unchanging, non-negotiable hatred that this holy God has for sin. That hasn't changed. Don't be deceived. God is not mocked. What a man sows, that shall he also reap. And so, wow, what you have right now is this glimpse into his holiness. A glimpse into his absolute, unequivocal hatred towards sin. He hates it. But he's the only one who can rightfully deal with it. It's God and God alone who can handle this. Not David, not me, not you. We can't handle it. We can't handle it. I can handle it. You can't handle it justly. You will handle it, and you'll handle it to the best of your ability, only seeing this much. God sees everything from the beginning to the end, Alpha and Omega, beginning and the end, and he handles it. He handles it justly. And so that's the condition of it all. But what caused it all? Look at Psalm 36 real quick. Here's the cause of it all. Look at verse 1. There's no fear of God before his eyes. That's the cause of the condition of Psalm 35. The cause is that you got this oracle within my heart concerning the transgression of the wicked, and there's no fear. There is no fear of God before his eyes. Flatters himself in his own eyes, finds out his iniquity when he hates the words of his mouth are wickedness and deceit. He has ceased to be wise, ceased to do good, devises wickedness on his bed, sets himself in a way that is not good, and he does not abhor evil. He doesn't hate it. He doesn't loathe it. He actually kind of likes it. Sinfulness is fun. The Bible says it's enticing. It's fun. It's pleasurable for a season. So here's you got the condition, you got the cause, you got the cure, and you got the claim. What's the cure? The cure can't be, let them have it, Lord. Get down here and nuke them all. The cure is verse 5, mercy. Your mercy, O Lord, is in the heavens. Your faithfulness reaches to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the great mountains. Your judgments are a great deep. This is deep. This is a deep, heavy portion of the book of Psalms. And it's just showing us this well of the mercies of God. Listen, striking them a blow and responding hatefully to the hate that is coming your way isn't going to fix the problem. Do you know that's not going to fix anything? It's your kindness that leads us to repentance. It's your mercy. That's the cure. And so claim this. Here's the claim. Verse 7. How precious is your loving kindness, O God. Therefore, the children of men put their trust under the shadow of your wings. That's where you go with this. And you want to vent about it? Vent away. But don't take matters into your own hands. Don't become like the wicked all around you. They've instigated. Don't retaliate. Turn the cheek. Offer a cloak. You can vent, you can cry, you can emote, but at the end of the day, this is God's job description, not ours. And we are to take refuge under the shadow of his wings. Claim that. Claim that. They are abundantly satisfied with the fullness of your house. You give them drink from the river of your pleasures. That's the only thing that's going to satisfy you. Not blowing up your enemy. It's taking refuge, abundantly finding your satisfaction in the Lord. In the Lord. Verse 9, for with you is the fountain of life, and in your light we see light. Haters are going to hate. This is just the reality of a fallen planet spinning out of control. Haters are going to hate, and hurt people hurt people. So you run to the Lord with it. You run to the Lord with it. And you will see things that you would have been blinded by if you let anger get the best of you. In your light we see light. Oh, continue your loving kindness to those who know you and your righteousness to the upright in heart. And then he continues. Here's a few bonus lets that he wraps up with. He says, let not the foot of pride come against me. And let not the hand of the wicked drive me away. You know what I think he's saying there? He's saying, let me not become like them. Let me be, in light of all the putrefying pollution that I am inundated with, let me be salt. Which preserves from all the pollution that surrounds. Let me be salt that preserves in light of all the pollution that surrounds. And let me be salt and let me be light. Regardless of how dark it gets, in your light we see light. Let not the foot of pride come against me. The foot of pride, see, he sort of like puts the brakes on. And says, I'm not going to take matters into my own hands. I'm not going to run ahead of the Lord. I'm not going to play God. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. And it would be very prideful for me to start acting like I'm God, take matters into my own hands. This isn't my job description. This is God's job. He's much better at it than we are. And so he prays. He prays. Let not the foot of pride come against me. Let me not be like them. Let not the hand of the wicked drive me away. And it's sadly the wickedness of this world has driven a lot of people away from the Lord and away out of fellowship, away from the church. It breaks my heart. The workers of iniquity have fallen and they have been cast down and they're not able to rise. Let that not be said of us. He prays. And don't underestimate the power of prayer. Don't be like, well, okay, pray. Prayer is the greatest thing you could do. Don't judge, pray. He's the judge. Judge not, lest you be judged. Judge not. Pray. Pray to the judge. And don't act. He'll act. He'll act. And he will act righteously. We act out of revenge. He will act righteously. And don't curse him. No. Love him. Cursing is not in your wheelhouse. Cursing is not in your department. Cursing is not in your area. You put this psalm on a shelf and declare, hands off, Lord, this is your department. This is your wheelhouse. I'm going to pray. Here's what I'm going to pray. I'm going to pray what you taught me to pray. Thy kingdom come. Amen. That's a powerful prayer right there. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Where? On earth as it is in heaven. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We don't go after them. I'm getting hacked left and right on Instagram from a bunch of people that are trying to take advantage. I'm like, sick them, God. Go. I don't wrestle against flesh and blood, against principalities and powers and rulers of darkness. It's going to be salt. I'm going to be light. This psalm, don't incubate this psalm. Don't germinate this psalm. Don't cultivate this psalm. Don't communicate this psalm. Delegate it. Yes. Hand it over to the Lord and say, this is your department. And I'm trusting you with it. Amen? Amen. What do? We just pray for the strength to take a step away from the ledge where the devil... I'm telling you exactly, straight up. I'm telling you, I'm reading you his mail right now. His strategy against you is to try and get you to retaliate for how you have been wrongly treated. And I'm not saying it wasn't wrong. It's totally wrong. Don't be like them. You're a new creation in Christ Jesus. You've been set free. Whom the Son sets free is free indeed. So pray all the more. And Lord, we do. We just pray in Jesus' name that you would confuse the plans and strategies of the evil one. We pray, Lord, that you would bind Satan in Jesus' name. Pray that you would give us a heart that would rest under the shadow of your wings. That as evil and as corrupt and as demonic as it is getting out there, allow for us, Lord, to fulfill the great commission that you have called us to go into all the world and to be the salt and to be the light, to see people set free. And I just pray your blessing and authority over these families and over these marriages and over these children and over these grandchildren, Lord, and that we have seen a glimpse into part of your character this morning through a psalm that sadly for so many is just discarded and overlooked. And yet, Lord, it shows to us how we can trust in you all the more. And in doing so, you will allow for us to be the overcomers that you have promised us to be in these last days. And to that end, we give you all the praise and all the honor and all the glory. In Jesus' name. And everyone agree and said amen. Come on, let's all stand.